All right. Hey, kids. We're going to talk about abortion today.
You know, nothing too heavy. Fucking Tuesday.
It's going to keep it light this Tuesday movie experience with this movie that I never heard of until, like, Thursday of last week, because I've been keeping my, I never know which of these movies are gonna come here, honestly, because I've been keeping my eye out for that Columbine one that Dave and I got. Oh, you haven't seen that trailer yet?
Gonna look well, a little shocked and appalled for a second. Yeah, no, do tell.
Oh, right. I forget it's usually just me and Dave who sees these trailers. Oh,
like
yeah.
Faith-based Dave.
Faith-based Dave. Yeah, like, so, it's I'm Not Ashamed. It's a Pure Flix movie about Columbine that came out, like, a couple weeks ago, but it hasn't made it to Springfield yet. So I've been keeping my eye out to see if it comes to Parkway, most likely. But then, all of a sudden, I see a listing for this. I could tell from the title. You know what? I'm going to put money on the fact that this is maybe... this is maybe a faith-based movie. So I look at the synopsis. War veteran wants to stop abortion clinic. Yep. Okay. All right. So I love...
So this isn't that sequel to Mute Witness I've been waiting for.
God, man, I love it when I get blindsided by one of these. Like I did with Old Fashioned, which is weird because, boy, do these two make a good double feature. I like how you didn't know until you got here what this movie was even called.
Yeah, My phone's over here providing lighting for me right now, but no, I had no fucking clue what this thing was even called.
Like, because I forgot about that, because when I asked you about it, I was like, I just gave you the plot synopsis, like, I didn't tell you the, it's like, dude, there's some anti-abortion thing, like, a war vet, like, I don't know, Travis Bickle comes back and, like, wants to stop, like, the Planned Parenthood across the street.
I think the way you worded it was, a war veteran tries his damnedest.
Dude, I'm
like, well, yeah, I've got to see this.
Thing is, like, I'm actually really not feeling very well, so I'm not 100% sure this movie actually happened. Normally it is me and Dave at these, but look, with a movie like this, I didn't know if there was going to be, like, graphic imagery of dead babies in it.
Welcome back.
Like, all right. I'll text Brian, hey man, you want to go see this? And we were talking about this in the bathroom too, when I said, like, we need to not tell Dave or Sarah about this until we do our worst list.
Yeah, none at all. No information.
Sarah's, what's voiceless? Well,
you'll find out in January.
It's this little thing that Brian and I went to go see. This movie is weird. And not because I'm on, like, kind of a cold high right now. Now, you may know I've seen a lot of movies like this. Well, not exactly, maybe not exactly like this, but...
No, tell me about all the abortion clinic movies you've watched.
I can think of a couple. There was Loving the Bad Man, which was the one where the girl was raped and decided to keep it, and Stephen Baldwin played a prison dude or something. This movie is filmed like The Dark Knight compared to that film. There was October Baby, which I think was the people who did War Room. And then there's this. Now, whenever I've done, like, a snob episode on stuff like Old Fashioned or, like, Second Glance or probably even God's Not Dead, there's always, like, a moment in there where I'll take, like, sinister horror movie music and put over some scenes that kind of make it look like a thriller, like a stalker thriller. That is this entire fucking movie.
This one beat you too, because there is almost always like this oppressive, just like single note at a time, like
yeah.
Music, like someone like when you're just like fucking around with the piano, just dun,
mm-hmm.
dun,
Yeah.
Done. These just long tracking shots with no dialogue. Like this movie, we were talking about that in the theater.
Mm-hmm.
Because I really didn't give a shit if we were talking too loud to...
There was a couple people there. They were way in the back, though. Like, we were in our usual seats. There was a family, which... What? They were sitting, like, far in the back.
Let's go see a movie, kids.
Another thing that makes this also feel like a thriller is the fact that, like... Okay, stuff like God's Not Dead, old-fashioned, as sinister as some of those movies can get... They're filmed like you would expect movies like that to look. They're very, like, bright. They're very bright looking. This is shot like The Wire!
But yeah, it's very depressing looking, but with the shots and angles, it legitimately feels like they hired, like, a DP who's like, all right, man, like, it's like, what kind of film you're like? Well, we're doing, like, this one about, like, abortion clinics, like... So you mean you want me to shoot it like Taxi Driver?
Yeah!
It's like, that sounds close.
There's driving scenes that look like Taxi Cab Confessions. Like, seriously, Seven has more sunnier landscapes in it than this movie does. What the shit?
Like, this guy is legitimately, like, I kept waiting for him to go, like, buy a gun.
Mm-hmm.
Just at some point buy a gun or... Just start fucking killing women and taking them back to his house, like,
dude, man.
Fucking,
this it was like,
crazy, you know, like, yeah. I saved you now. Aren't you happy?
That it,
well, don't
it's
talk
insane.
Out of line. And then just stacking them in the closet and closing the door. Honey, what were you doing in there? Nothing, dear.
It seriously feels like someone decided to make like a faith-based movie that takes place in the same universe as Combat Shock. Like, this is such a bizarre sit. And I don't mean that to say, like, that this is a hard R. It's not. It's a PG-13. I saw it going in. But I saw that on the thing going in. But it's like you just said. Like, you could logistically... No matter how many movies like this have stuff in it that you may, like, ideologically disagree with, this movie, you could logistically make a point that it is deep down a pro-choice film.
Oh, yeah, because... The main character in this movie, if it were any other movie, is the villain.
We noticed this when I IMDb'd him afterwards. He was one of the villains in that Unsullied movie that Dave and I went to go see. He was in that, and it's... Every time this character is on screen, it's like he's one James O'Keefe video away from blowing up this abortion clinic that's across...
Oh, yeah, like, at a point, they even, like, his wife even jokes around, like, because, like, the cops are talking to his wife, because at this point, like, he's physically accosted people, he's tried barring people from going into this clinic, like, yeah. All kinds of shit.
He's straight up gone in and just harassed them, and this is, like...
You're killing babies! Yeah. You're killing babies! And, like, has to get dragged out, and then beats up the security guard.
Yeah.
And then goes home, like, that didn't happen.
And he often gets confronted by apparently the only two cops that exist in this goddamn universe. There's two cops in the movie, and it feels like one of our movies in that regard. Yeah. Like, it's Officer Randy is gonna pop up and...
Well, I got called around again. Thought we talked about this.
God, like it's really, it's unsettling, because...
Yeah, like, it's just, you keep waiting for the other shoe to drop, like there's gonna be, like, one more thing, and just that
yeah.
little bit that's left in there is gonna go wrong, and then it's gonna be him, like, cause, okay, the setup with this movie is that on this, like, there's basically this road,
mm-hmm.
like, most of this takes place on one or the other side of this one street, or just standing in the middle of the street.
Yeah.
But on this one street, on the left, or I don't know which...
Whichever
I don't know directions. Looking. On this side,
mm-hmm.
there's a church and, like, the community outreach center that this guy is setting up, and he lives right above it. And then on this side of the street is a women's clinic that offers a full line of services that you could possibly need.
Yeah.
Including abortions. So of course, at one point, they refer to it as a murder mill.
That happened when I went to go get some napkins. At one point, I come back in and Brian's like, "So the old lady just referred to it as a murder mill."
So that just happened.
What? I go like, "Did she literally say that?" Yep. And yeah, like, and so the first half hour,
so he spends like half the movie like just looking out his bedroom window at night, with like really artsy shot with like the shadows kind of like slats over his face, like that, just staring down, and all you can see is just like the Women's Clinic of Frankfurt or something like that. It's like those motherfuckers. I just kept waiting for him to be like sitting there with like a high powered rifle, just picking off like people in scrubs.
I lean over to you. I'm like, this is. This close to turning into Maniac. Like,
it's gonna fucking happen. Like, yeah. He is gonna goddamn lose it.
And what makes it more intense is his acting is not bad. Like, it's not. Like, I've seen far worse acting in this kind of movie. Like, this guy is sort of like if Clay Walsh in Old Fashioned was played by an actor with experience, which makes it scarier. It makes it far more scary, because at the end of the day, it seems like he's playing a he is playing a psychopath.
Oh yeah, no, this guy is straight up over the fucking line.
And it's not like they go like this batshit route where it just straight up says like abortion clinic or something like that.
It's like, not even listed on their sign, like as far as like services they offer. Like, cause on the outside, like they have a dual sign, like there's like the like women's clinic, blah blah, and then there's another sign that says like it's like wellness checkups, prenatal whatever.
STI.
You know, they do like testing for stuff. Like they've got a few different things. It doesn't so like, oh, and we murder babies. Like, they left that off the sign.
So
maybe you can only see it if you're a fucking insane person.
Yes! Because, like, the first half hour of this is kind of him dealing with other things, like putting together this community outreach program and, like, dealing with coming home from the war and, like, the wound he has on his knee. But in the first half hour of this, like, four times, it'll break away from, like the other stuff he's doing.
Like, he just kind of occasionally, like, at times, like, he'll be doing stuff. He's like, all right, we're going to make this community better. And then he'll glance across the street and boom.
Yeah, like women's clinic. And I'm sitting there like,
yep.
Because God forbid, what the fuck, movie?
Well, and it's especially one of those movies that you keep waiting for him to finally go fucking crazy because absolutely nothing in this movie goes right for him. Like every time, like he'll try to like break up a fight and get punched in the face, and then the cops show up like, "Hey, you fucking fighting?" and try to arrest him.
Yeah,
you know, he tries to like, you know, help out somebody, and then they just like throw it back in his face.
Well, the fucking
like,
reverend
every goddamn time. Like, yeah, even like the preacher at the church,
James Russo. Yeah,
he's like, "Hey, we should talk about this clinic across the street." He's like, if you want to, man. I mean,
the freaking reverend at this church is basically like the mayor from Jaws.
He's worried about like, it's like, well, we don't want to cause a fuss here. We're a church. It's like
we got to get our attendance up. Like you bring them in and we make sure that they're led right to the man upstairs. Like, it's like he's treating it as like it's a vacation hotspot, and they're worried about numbers and attendance. And
yeah, this isn't a fucking Sandals. Like, you'll be fine. He also plays it half the time like the mayor from Jaws, and the other half of the time like he's some kind of fucking mafia boss.
Like he's the mafia guy from Jaws 5.
Those cruel jaws. But yeah, like one point he like he's in his office, like this is after the cops have had to arrest the main character again for fighting in public.
Yeah.
And he's like talking to him, like, what the fuck are you doing? The last thing I need around here is the cops coming through these doors. It's like, why? You're a church. That should be, I mean, maybe not the reason they're coming in, but why don't you want the fucking cops here so bad? Like, he is crazy, like, against, like, like, anytime someone's, like, showing any sort of, like, notice about wanting to say something that'll get the word out about this church, he shoots that shit down.
Yeah.
But he still wants them to get their numbers up. So it's like, why don't you want people knowing about this church? Like, what the fuck are you doing?
It's the church from Dolomite. They're smuggling guns inside of it. Like,
yeah, I can't wait.
That's gotta be the only... Like,
there's another movie where all this shit's going on in the front of the church, and he's in the back, like...
Mm.
Like, fucking in Lost, like, packing heroin into, like, statues like the Virgin Mary.
Yeah.
Like, the church basement is just, like, 15 Filipino broads, like, standing around in their underwear, just shoving it in there. And another one just sitting there like, yep, paint it up, looks like the Virgin, put it in a box.
Well, how about, too, when the cops, again... I want to reiterate, the only two cops in this universe.
And this is Philadelphia, by the way.
When they go
it's
up
it's not
to...
like it's a small town or some, like, nondescript, fictitious place. It's Philadelphia.
Yeah. And like, when he, when they go up to the dude's wife, like you mentioned earlier, and they were making sure, you know, that... the main character wasn't making fucking napalm in his house, which, understandably, that's a good question you want to be asking this guy's wife. And then...
Because, yeah, he has had, again, several violent outbursts that the, that the police have had to respond to.
So then he, the husband, the main character, shows up and says...
Like, because you could see them across the street. He's, like honking at this car who's at a stop sign. So why the fuck aren't they getting out of the way? He's, like, slamming his steering wheel. And then he just pulls up on the curb and just jumps out and walks across the street. It's like, hey, why are you talking to my wife?
Yeah, he's like, why are you harassing me? I'm like, motherfucker, that is all you've been doing this entire film. So
it's like, I am a professional and I know what it looks like. You are harassing me now.
Yeah, he just, he stands outside.
Don't tread on me, bro. Don't tread on me.
He stands outside of this clinic. Just automatically assuming they're all going in there for abortion. Some of them just straight up say, like, dude, I'm not here. Leave me alone. Like, I'm just here to get a checkup.
Yeah, it's time for my monthly pap. Like yeah. Not monthly, yearly. But yeah, it's like, they hit those very frequent. But women out there be like, it's like, I think that's only like a 3-year thing. Like, monthly, you should see a real doctor. But no, like, yeah, like, he's like, it's like, oh, here, ma'am, you'll want to read this. I'm like, I'm not fucking pregnant, and throws it back at him. Was like,
yeah.
Like, oh, you thought just because she was a big girl.
No, did you, oh, what
real
about the part
women
where
have
he,
curves, you dick.
Did you notice when he handed it to the 70-year-old?
Yeah, it's like, you're going to want to read this. She's like waving him off, like, she has white hair.
Yeah.
Like, I know that medicine's gone a lot of places that it shouldn't these days. But come the fuck on. That is someone's grandmother.
This whole movie is him pulling shit out of his ass. Like, when he says, like, when he's talking in front of the church and he says, like, they're doing 20 abortions a day over there.
Over across the street, they're doing 5 to 20. That is a broad spectrum of numbers
of
abortions
a
day. It's like,
how do you know this?
You don't know anyone who works there. You've tried talking to them and they've called security on you. And you tried going in there and they threw you out literally on your ass.
Mm-hmm. Which, understandably so, they get security on this guy. Like, him going up to the nurse. It's like, motherfucker, we live in a world where shit like this makes people shoot up Planned Parenthoods and blow up clinics. Yeah, you're gonna make them fucking nervous going up to them like that.
I was really waiting, especially because the scene where he goes in there trying to, because he keeps trying to, like, ask, like, information about, like, specific people he saw walk up. And they're like, we can't talk about that. That is medical information. We cannot tell you. And he's, like, looking at him like, what the fuck? What the fuck? I'm asking. You gotta tell me.
Goddamn, he goes to the girl's funeral. One girl, like, kills herself.
We should probably break that one down a little bit.
Yeah.
All right, so...
There's plenty of other shit that... There's a lot of shit that happens in this movie.
This is a big part of it. It's what really kicks off his crusade, is that he's getting ready one day. He's opening up the gates out in front of the church, and there's this girl leaning up against, like, one of the railings there, like, just staring across the street at this clinic.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, hey, you need any help? She's like, Can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Will my baby go to heaven with me?
What? Like, I haven't had my coffee yet.
It's like, when I get to heaven, my baby will be there and I'll get to see it there, right?
This is some Riddler shit.
And he's like, well... he's like, because God forgives, right? He's like, that's a complicated...
No, it's really not. That is really not a complicated question.
Like, I've seen plenty of signs that have it so that pretty clear. Jesus forgives. God forgives. I mean, it seems pretty fucking straightforward.
Yeah. Yeah, the end of this movie, too, they also say that God has forgiven them for the same situation. So...
But it's complicated for this girl, and so she freaks out and runs straight across the street to the clinic.
Mm-hmm.
And then, like, the next day, he goes over there to try, like, asking information about her. They won't give it to him. And, there's, like, a couple of scenes that go by, and it just keeps splicing back to, like, this girl, like, at her house, just walking around. She's got, like, a little picture of, like the first, like, sonogram and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
And... then it cuts to something else, like a scene of like just a little bit of dialogue, like somebody doing something. And when it cuts back, this girl is laying flat on the floor, stone fucking dead, because she killed herself.
And it was, by the way, there was front page news too.
In Philadelphia,
yeah.
Slow news day, because local college student takes life was a front page story.
I lean over to you. I'm like, Tommy Doyle survives babysitter massacre.
Oh, thank God. I still love that headline. It's like, what about the babysitter that survived? Or the other girl that
Lindsay
was there?
Wallace! What about Lindsay Wallace? Where's, again, you flipping it, where is, like, local teen Ben Traber killed in possibly a related incident?
Oh, he's buried on, like, page 8. Like, that's a small story. There was enough other shit going on.
Like, we...
yeah, so this guy gets the genius idea in his head of, I tried helping that girl. I'm obligated now. I'm going to show up at her fucking funeral.
Which he gets thrown out of, by the way.
But yeah, she, he goes to her funeral, like to the visitation, and, goes up and, you know, is like, you know, sees her, is like, ah, I could have done more. Should have helped. Like, you could see it's taking its toll on him, and he goes up, and you know, like the mother is like, "Oh, I'm sorry for your loss," and the father like, "Oh, you know, my sympathies," and what I can only assume was probably like her brother or something, mm-hmm. standing there, is like, "So who are you? How did you know her?" It's like, "Oh, well, I work at this church," they're like. You're the sixth.
Whoa.
You're the son of a bitch that put that shit in her head. You fucking are the reason she got things so twisted. She's fucking dead now. Goddamn guilt tripping her. And like the whole family, like everybody there. So it's like closing in on him.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, I was just trying to help. I'm sorry for your loss. I'm sorry. But like, get the fuck out of here.
Oh, and as if that wasn't awkward enough, it's okay. He goes into the clinic and takes the girl's picture and starts showing it to every woman in the waiting room, going like, you see this? This is what this place did to her. She's dead now. She killed herself. Which clearly means we should make all this illegal now.
it's just, this movie makes a good point of showing you that... yeah, there is literally nothing illegal about these clinics. It goes really far out of its way to point that out.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he tries, like, asking the pastor to lodge a complaint with the city, and he's like, I don't know, I'll look into it. I mean, I've tried before, and it got nowhere, so mm-hmm. I don't know what you want me to do. And he tries going that route. That doesn't work, so he just goes right to like the city like courthouse,
mm-hmm.
to lodge like a formal complaint. And they're like, so what are you complaining about? It's like, oh, well, there's this abortion clinic. It's like, well, are they doing anything illegal? He's like, not that I know of. They're like, all right.
Then piss off.
Yeah, there's literally nothing you can do then, because these are all absolutely legal by the note of the law.
And the thing is this, here's a couple of things that, like I mentioned earlier, like, wow, this guy is such a fucking psychopath that you could make the case this is secretly a pro-choice movie. But it isn't. It seems
like it's going out of its way to show you just how okay it is that clinic is up and running and providing the services that it does.
Here's how you know that this is not a pro-choice film, that this is the kind of movie that it is. It's because this movie is made by men, starring men, prominently just featuring men. I've seen women better represented in gay porn than I have in this film. It's insane. The main character is this psycho dude. The movie's written and directed by some other guy. There are scenes in this movie where they're having a conversation about whether a girl in the scene should keep their baby or not, or what other people feel about it, and the girl who actually is pregnant has no lines.
Well, that's because it's important that her man is the one making the decision.
Yeah, that is this kind of movie. This is the kind of movie where he opens up like a neighborhood self-defense thing in which apparently it's only dudes in danger of getting raped in this neighborhood, because it's all guys in there.
He's like, oh, I'm starting up this boxing class, but then he's showing him how to, like disarm somebody. It's like a fucking Take Back the Night class, except it's just big, like, swole-up dudes.
Yeah.
It's like, that one guy, like, I'm sure he'll be fine. Like, he's big as shit. I'm sure he's okay.
There are not one, but two scenes in which that pregnant girl in the film has no lines, in which her situation is
about her.
Yeah, the one where, like, it's all about how the boyfriend feels, really. Like,
well, and it even goes like weird routes. Like at a point, this pregnant girl and her boyfriend start living with this old lady that has ties to the church, because she says, like, oh, well, if I have this baby, my mom's going to kick me out. So she starts living with, like, this old church lady.
This old Scottish church lady who's, like, a Mike Myers character. And I'm not even under-exaggerating. Like, she has a joke in it about her own crap at one point in the film. It just sounds like Fat Bastard started giving dialogue for some reason.
Yeah. But, yeah, it's fucking weird. But they go and they're staying with her for a little bit. And they all sit down to, like, eat dinner, and they're like, it's like, oh, we've got to pray before we eat. And they're like, okay. Everybody's like, sits there, like, waiting. The dude kind of looks up, and she's like, well, what are you waiting for? You're the man at the table, aren't you? You lead. He's like, it's a man in charge. And, like, the main guy, the fucking psycho that is the main character in this movie, his wife is very against him.
Mm-hmm.
And, but for all of the right reasons. Mm-hmm. Like, in any other movie, she would be, like, the grounded character who's trying to reel him back into you know, his right state of mind. In this, she's a shrill harpy who just won't get with the fucking program.
Yeah.
And it leads to them fighting a lot and seeming like, like, shit, like, maybe they're gonna, like, get a divorce, because she keeps, like toying, like, pulling her ring on and off and shit like that. And
because he's prepared to go to prison for this.
Yeah. He has stated, like, well, they'll just have to fucking arrest me, I don't know.
I guess I could be a minister in prison. Bro. But it turns out the reason why he's like this is because it turns out 6 years ago, apparently when they were kids, even though he's played by a 43-year-old man.
But even at that, it's like, okay, yeah, I could buy that he can play younger than 40s. But even at that, what would that make him like? Like, I pegged him for maybe like 35. So I'm like, it's like, okay, so yeah, like when he was 30, they were high school sweethearts and got an abortion. Like,
yeah. So he and his wife live with a bunch of over getting an abortion 6 years prior. She seems to be dealing with it far better than he is.
Oh, no, no. He's dealing with it just fine by denying it ever happened. Just bottling up all those feelings inside until he's some kind of uncontrollable rage beast. You know, like a man does. Mm-hmm.
They made a choice, which means no one else can. Oh, another...
Yeah, they wait until 75% of the way through the movie to point out, like, oh, and by the way, he's a massive hypocrite.
Yeah. Also, another reason why you can tell that this is a this is the kind of movie that it is because there is a shootout near the end of this film. Because every situation that it gives you in this, it's never a thing like to where it's for health reasons, meaning like, look, we have to do something or the mother's gonna die, or it's a situation of like incest or rape or anything like that.
Or yeah, like hey, we came back with these test results and there is a 95% chance your baby's gonna be born without bones or some shit. Mm-hmm. Like, we would recommend.
Uh-huh. It's not anything like that. The situation we're given at the end of this film is this abusive, much older husband forces his young wife there to the clinic, and because she's pregnant but with someone else's baby.
Which, that woman looked like fucking Ann Coulter.
She was pretty skinny. Blonde. Yeah, I can see that. Like, maybe 20 years younger.
It was Philly, maybe it was Sweet D.
That's true. If this is in the same universe, oh shit. I'm sorry, my head just went to the baby funeral episode. Somehow that's got to tie into this.
What was his name? Barnabas?
Yeah. So the abusive husband is trying to force his young wife there because the kid is somebody else's. She's got a black eye.
Which this clinic would not give those services to her if, like he was literally dragging her into the clinic the first time they went. Like, they're not going to be like, all right, well, we're just gonna rip it right at the fuck at you. Like, yep, let's do this.
No. When he goes back the second time, it gets more serious because he pulls out a fucking gun in the street like he's just going to fucking blow every single one of them away. But he doesn't because, again, one of only two cops in this film fucking blows his ass and fucking just unloads in this guy. Here's the best part. Here's how subtle this fucking movie is. The guy is, like, dead on the ground. There's a pool of blood, and
you see it slowly stretching into the street.
And in the reflection in the blood, you see the sign for the women's clinic.
Hands up, camera focus, women's clinic. It's like, yep, that's what caused it. Not this guy harassing him, threatening him with physical violence in the middle of the street, emasculating him, and then, like, nothing to do with that guy.
Like, man, this, it's okay, because by the end of the film, they all learn to, like, peacefully protest, I guess, maybe in a way that won't get people killed.
Hopefully. So this guy's racking them up.
The lady, the poor lady who runs this clinic, my God. There's like the anti-abortion people are all get together at the church. They march down the street. The lady who runs the clinic looks out and says to the cop, like, can't you do something about this? And the cop's like, hey, yeah, there's nothing I can do. They're 30 feet away.
They're standing dead in the middle of the street.
Mm-hmm.
Like, well, the right distance away. I'm like,
they're technically jaywalking.
Yeah, they're all roaming across the street. Like, we're shown several times that this is a really busy street. Like, people are almost hit on this street a couple times.
Yeah.
And so they're holding up traffic. But yeah, I thought that was kind of one of the rules of like peaceful protesting is like as long as you're like you know, on the sidewalk, but not off the curb, but not interfering with, like, the flow of business.
Mm-hmm. If the clinic made any mistake in this film, maybe...
It's not pressing charges the first time and having him arrested.
Oh, well, that... Definitely. Definitely that.
That would have saved them a lot of headache, and that one dude would still be alive.
But maybe across this... Maybe across the street from the church, yeah,
To be fair... To be fair, it is literally 30 feet away from the church's front door. Mm-hmm. Like, it's... I mean, yeah, I understand available real estate and what you can swing on a budget. Mm-hmm. I get that.
Mm-hmm.
But, man, that was a gutsy realtor who's like, you know what? I got this one more place uptown. Hold on.
Mm-hmm.
Hold on. Let me call... Janice, is that one still... Yeah, across from... Okay. Let me show you this place. It's fucking great. Low overhead, nice part of town, conveniently located underneath a train overpass. Like, mm-hmm. you'll love it. It is across from a church, but...
but you get to meet James Russo.
$1,200 a month. I mean, how can you pass?
Fine. All right. It's still open by the end of the movie, by the way.
They don't, like, it's not like it closes or something. They protested out there and they're like, yeah, we've won the day.
Mm-hmm.
And they're like, you going to do this every single day for the rest of your lives or what? Because they're back open for business still tomorrow mm-hmm. and the next day. It's a clinic. It's like 7 days a week. Like, there's somebody there.
Yeah.
Like, I feel like part two of this movie is him just blowing the place up.
Yeah, uh-huh.
I kind of figured part one of this movie was going to end with him blowing the place up.
He's got to shoot Harvey Keitel as the sport the pimp first across the street. Then he'll go in there. He'll pull out Jodie Foster from the back room. God, this is ridiculous. This is...
That security guard just following him. I'll kill you.
Yeah, that is the... If this movie was realistic at all...
If this movie was realistic, that guy would be on a fucking watch list.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He would have the feds, like, offering to sell him guns mm-hmm. just to get him on record saying it so they could arrest him.
It's like if you made... Just, God damn, this movie is fucked up. It really is like if
it's, it's like a propaganda film.
Well, yeah.
Well, I mean, it is a propaganda film. But no, it's like a propaganda film that doesn't follow through with the last step that they're trying to logically lead you to.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's like they want to say, so just shoot the place up.
Mm-hmm.
But they know they fucking well can't.
Yeah. So let's just go ahead and make our righteous movie and have the lead character from Don't Go in the House be the fucking character. Guinea Pig has more respect for women than this movie does. This is insane.
But a great example of that is his shrill, ununderstanding wife who does nothing but complicate his life, finally gets the message at the end.
Uh-huh.
Like, after this shootout that leaves a man dead, this woman, like, who didn't want to get an abortion, like, crying in the street because, like, yeah, she didn't want to get an abortion, but that was still her fucking husband that got shot in the street like a dog.
Mm-hmm.
Who now, due to the traumatic nature and stress of this, will probably just miscarry anyway.
Yeah.
Good going, buddy. Saved one. He almost gets arrested, but they completely let him off the hook because he's white and was in the service.
Mm-hmm.
Like, well, due to your exemplary and exceptional military record, we'll let you off in no time to serve.
They
$200 fine.
$200.
Click. It's like, wow. This is the same kind of...
Damn.
Yeah, this is the same kind of judge. It's like, you raped an 8-year-old repeatedly until she was in her 20s.
18 months.
Yeah, 6 months if you do community service, and we'll even wipe it from your record.
Good luck at the swim championship.
So... lets him off, and he's gonna go back to the church, and And he's like, well, his wife argues with the pastor. Like, it's like, he'll do better. We promise. He'll knock all this shit out. Just let him apologize to the congregation. He's like, all right. So Sunday comes around. He's sitting there writing out an apology speech. He's getting ready to go up there. And she's like, wait. I got this. Wife goes up there and is like, you know what? I thought he was crazy too. Yeah, tap the mic. Mm-hmm. Like, it's been working this whole time.
Yeah.
And he's like, yeah, I know my husband's been acting like a psychopath. I agree with you. But you know what? I don't agree with you. Because it took my husband showing me what the real power of the Lord is. I will be standing by his side. You know, he wants to go out there and protest. I will go out there with him. If we go to jail, we will go to jail together. Assuming it's a co-ed jail that they suddenly have.
Again, the violence in a women's prison jail. I don't remember what review we brought that up in recently, but it was one reason.
Well, shit, when he went to that soup kitchen, like that weird, like Latin, like samba music that was playing, I'm like, it's like, are they just watching Oz in there?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, when it turns into a sitcom for 10 minutes because it's Paul Rodriguez who runs it. My name's Guapo. Yeah, sure it is. Look, at the end of the day, I'm just glad that a group of men like this have finally have their voice.
They've cracked in women's health. They've cracked the code.
I'm just so glad.
It took an entire team of men in a movie about men featuring three women to really get the message out there.
By the way, the irony's not lost on me that it's also two men reviewing this movie.
What do you want?
But at least we know everything that's wrong with this. Look,
we've got like three women associated with this at this point. This is a long way for Allison to drive just to watch this shit.
And I can't ask Sarah, Sarah's return to the midnight screenings. I can't ask her to this.
That's a bad one. And Letty would just wave from the back, give it a thumbs down.
That would be like we're sitting there talking about this, and just Letty's just voiceless in the back seat.
Oh my god!
And break Jillian out of retirement.
Well, and the fact that partway through this movie, he even like they title drop the film, but it's even because the main guy is saying that he wants to be the one to give a voice to the voiceless.
Big strong man.
Yeah.
Thank God.
Good thing he showed up with his boxing and his ministry.
Mm-hmm. With his sweet flannel and gold locks. He did have some rockin' flannel in that movie, by the way. I'm just saying.
But between him and his main guy that he was hanging out with, that real fucking oddly gigantic guy. Like, he looked like somebody overinflated a child.
The main guy?
No,
the guy who was the father.
Yeah.
That guy looked like, I was sitting there like, I can't tell if he's supposed to be playing a teenager and it's just a 40-year-old playing him, or if
this
he's
guy
just kind of odd looking.
Yeah, I can't even fucking remember what the kid's name was, but he was like,
oh God, me neither.
He was like the main guy's like bestie in this.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, no, he looks like a 13-year-old that you overinflated to like the size of Vin Diesel.
Yeah,
like it didn't look right that he was that fucking swole.
Mm-hmm.
But
he looked like a realistic drawing of a character from the PJs.
You know,
projects.
Because he's black.
What? I couldn't have said the non-black version of the PJs. That wouldn't have made sense. What am I going to say? Wallace and Gromit?
I was trying to think of any other claymation thing with white people. I'm like, yeah, it's pretty much just that.
Yeah.
I'm sure there's one, but fuck if I can think of it.
We know there's several.
But between, like, the main guy and him hanging out all the time is, like, it just kind of made me think, like, it's like, wow, if they were going to make a really, really terrible, like, faith-based, like, Fast and the Furious knockoff.
Fuck yeah.
Like, they got their, they got their guys right here.
Mm-hmm. Again, like, if there's just, if I could force myself to say anything positive, it's that I've seen movies like this that are way worse acted than this film, and that's about it. Like, the acting, I mean, it's not that it's great, it's just that for this kind of movie, it's not bad. Like, it's...
Well, I think it's a big part of it is because, like, basically, like, what you'd call, like, maybe, like, the like, four or five, like, actually, like, core characters in this...
Yeah.
...do okay.
Yeah.
And everybody else puts in the same level of acting as you would for, like, a title loan place commercial.
Oh, totally, yeah.
Like, everybody else is, like, delivering their lines, like, it's like, I took my car to Title Max, and they gave me $1,000. Thanks, Title Max.
Yeah.
Like, that's how every other person is delivering their lines. Like, they're giving back and forth dialogues, and it's clearly, like, one person is, like, it's like, yeah, I mean, we gotta talk for these women. It's like, I totally get you, dude.
Yeah.
It's like odd spaces in there. Like, they're not sure. Like, it's like, do I talk normal when okay, don't look at the camera. Don't look down the barrel. Look over here and then say things like, I don't know English. Gotcha. Mm-hmm.
Pretty much. Yeah.
It's like, my mom said that she will kick me out if I decide to keep this baby. It's like, got in one.
But the core cast was all right.
So like, it's so weird because since it is like it's just split straight down the middle. It's people that know what the fuck they're doing, and then people who have never done this before.
Yeah, it's like
it really does feel like some of those early movies with like you know, like Jackie Chan or Dolph Lundgren or like, you know, where it's like, okay, I know you don't speak a lick of English, but just sound this out phonetically.
Yeah.
Like, I'm going to write this down in Mandarin and you just say what these are sounding like. Mm-hmm. It's like, hello, nailed it. Said hello.
This is like you're watching The Protector, where it's like, I don't know how much Jackie Chan understands a lot of this, but Danny Aiello is doing perfectly fine.
Yeah, he'll pick up the slack.
Is there any possible way you'd recommend this? Like, even as, like...
If you want to convince someone to get an abortion...
Go see this.
Show them this movie to show them just how intolerable people are who don't want you to have one.
Yeah, pretty much. Like, this,
If you want to really... Like, if you've got, like, part of your... Like, if you're part of your crew... Is like oh man, yeah, there's like me, my friend Derek, and like oh man, like these three like hardcore feminist bitches we roll with. It's like, if you want to get a fucking rise out of them and see them get pissed, show them this movie.
That is the only fucking way. Like, we get together, like, me, you, Sarah, Dave, a bunch of people, like, we get together, like, put this shit on with a double feature of Old Fashioned. Holy fuck.
Like, let's just set, like Sarah and Bianca in front of this movie and just see how long it takes for one of them to just explode into flames.
Let's bring my mom into it, too.
She'd love it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. That is the only possible way that I could, like...
Just to show to your mom, just to like, the whole time, like...
Yeah.
What you think?
Other than that,
has it passed the Bechdel test yet?
Oh.
I'll wait.
I cannot possibly recommend this fucking movie. Like, this is terrible. This is an awful film. It's not even, like... There were a few times where I laughed at some unintentionally funny things in it. There were not enough for me to...
Yeah, like, it's not nearly, like, bad enough to be good.
Like, when the bow breaks and things like that. Like, it's not bad.
I mean, we spent most of the movie riffing on it, but It's like a lot of that was just like,
because what else were we gonna do?
Yeah, like, or they like, give you an opening big enough to fucking park a truck in. So I'm like,
yeah,
I gotta do something to kill time.
Look, we got an hour and 40 minutes to kill. Like we gotta say something.
Like, it's gonna be real awkward if we just both sit here in silence with this movie.
Yeah, fuck that. Voiceless my ass.
And I just, oh my god, just the fact that this movie, especially with the title, misses the mark so completely. Because not only does it not give a voice to the voiceless, you know, these unborn children, but it also goes out of its way to take away the voice from any woman in the film.
Yeah! I don't know why that surprised me so much. I should have fucking I knew the plot of this movie. But I'm like, yeah, again, like 30 minutes in, I'm like, this is all from the dude's point of view, isn't it? Like, that's what this movie is. My god. Alright, I guess if I have any final thought here, I'll say something else nice about it. It has more sets than Madea Halloween. That was the last terrible movie we saw.
That is true.
This looked like it probably took more than 6 days to make, which apparently is literally all it took Madea Halloween to make.
That doesn't surprise me.
Nope. It at least breaks from scenes every now and then.
Our filming time is longer than that.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Fuck. And that's when we don't have a production nightmare.
Whoever was on like Unit B photography did pretty well, like capturing like cityscapes and stuff like that, and trains going by, like everything that wasn't related to the film was shot fairly well, fairly competently. Like several of the scenes looked like they were filmed on like a cell phone camera.
Yeah, those nighttime driving scenes.
Yeah, it's like, oh man, like, you know, our cameras can't pick this up. Like, it's not on the Panasonic. Like, it's too dark. I can't open the gate anymore. Like I don't know. I've got this old iPhone 4.
Perfect.
Just hold on.
Shit, we're going over budget. Fuck.
Nailed it. Because, yeah, the nighttime stuff always looked like super, like, like they like fucked with like the hue and the saturations, like everything looked like it was like sun bleached at night.
Yeah,
like it was weird. Like everything just looked overly faded, and like let's just boost the contrast up really high. It's like now it just looks kind of foggy and cloudy. Like yeah, you can see them though.
Yeah, it's like at least like they shoot it better. They shoot nighttime better than David DeCoto does, which means they're not shooting it at noon. The freaking filter over. Really? Is that what I've come down to? Like, oh, it looks better than a talking cat.
Voiceless. Looks better than a talking cat, raves the cinemasnob.com.
That's not even taking me out of context, really. I literally did say that. All right, fine. Whatever.
Put that one in the win column.
Yeah.
Gotta take them wherever they can on this one.
So, coming up in a couple days is Trolls and Doctor Strange. Fuck yeah.
I'm excited for one of those.
You can't see Trolls. Me and Allison are going to be at that one.
Me.
Guess I'll just go watch Doctor Strange.
All right. See you later.